thanks a lot. Makes a lot of work, a bit low, but we'll work with it. Right, my name's Michael. Thanks to Craig for inviting me along today to speak a little bit about Business for Scotland, which is a group I work for. I do a bit of sort of research about Scotland's economy and about the reasons why there's a lot of economic strengths in Scotland becoming an independent country. And the more people I speak to about the referendum, one of the most common questions I hear is, can we afford it? And it's an understandable question that a lot of people have. They want more information, and they want to know what the impact will be on their finances, you know, the money that comes into their family at the end of the week, and about their work and about their jobs, and about what opportunities there would be in an independent Scotland. So that's what I'm going to hopefully lay out some of in this short speech. Just some of the reasons why Scotland is already a really wealthy country, but perhaps not a wealthy society. Secondly, I'm going to speak about some of the real opportunities, kind of the reason I think that independence is a big opportunity for Scotland's economy, and then I'll set out some of those opportunities quickly. So there was a recent report put out just a few months ago that said Scotland, on current gross national product figures, was the 14th richest country in the developed world. And that, I think, can come as quite a surprise to a lot of people, that Scotland is one of the wealthiest countries in the world, because I think a lot of people feel disconnected from that wealth and that statistic. But it's worth setting out, you know, some of those industries where people are employed. Scotland's wealth includes £21 billion in construction, which includes 170,000 jobs, £11.6 billion in tourism, which employs 292,000 people, £39 billion in manufacturing, which still employs around 127,000 people. Scotland's economy also includes 5 of the world's top 200 universities, which makes it one of the world's top locations for things like research and development and world-class education. 40,000 international students come here to study and learn. Scotland also has a flourishing creative sector in the arts and culture, which is worth £4 to £5 billion a year, and also has, of course, vast energy, fishing and agricultural resources. If you look at energy, that includes not only oil and offshore gas, but also includes tidal, wave and wind energy. So if you're talking about Scotland's economy, Scotland is a wealthy country. What other ways does this represent itself? Well, Scotland gives more to Westminster in terms of taxation per head of population than it gets back. So if you look at the official government figures, which is the government expenditure and revenue Scotland figures, and you look at them over the past 5 years, Scotland would have been £8.3 billion better off as an independent country. So for each person in this room, that equals £1,600. So if Scotland had been an independent country over the last 5 years, Scotland would have had greater resources available, which means we could have either had more spending on public services, lower taxation, or had less debt. So Scotland would have been better off as an independent country, which is really important. Another way that this manifests itself is when you look at taxation. So last year, Scotland generated £800 more per head than the UK average in taxation. So that was £800 more generated in Scotland than is average in the UK as a whole. So these are all accepted facts and figures by both sides of the debate. Like David Cameron says, even David Cameron says, there is no reason that Scotland couldn't be another successful independent country like Finland or Norway or Switzerland. That's what he wrote in the Telegraph newspaper in 2007. Everyone on the no side says the same thing, because the facts are the facts, that Scotland has what it takes to be an independent country. Last year, Scotland sold almost £100 billion worth of goods and services in international exports. So that includes things like whisky, which was worth £4.5 billion last year alone in terms of whisky export taxes. So that makes Scotland one of the top exporting nations. A 50% increase in that would generate 100,000 new jobs for the Scottish economy. Scotland also has, like, as opposed to some of the rumours or myths, actually has a lower public spending compared to its gross national product than the UK average. Over the last 5 years, it was 42.7% in Scotland and 45.4% in the UK as a whole. So that's another fact that is the facts, like, that Scotland is in a strong position in terms of its public finances. Also, contrary to the myths, North Sea oil is still recognised as a vast resource. According to the Oil and Gas UK regulation industry, which is, you know, London based, it's still worth over £1 trillion, with at least 15 to 24 billion barrels of oil already identified, which will continue long into the 21st century for at least another couple of generations. Over 90% of that future tax would go to an independent Scotland. That's verified by the University of Aberdeen. So once again, it's another set of facts that prove that Scotland is a wealthy nation. Scotland also has huge potential in renewable energy. It has 25% of Europe's tidal energy, 25% of wind power, and 10% of wave energy. So Scotland has a huge opportunity there to lead the world in terms of new technology and new jobs. So I think that hopefully helps counter a lot of the fears that people have, that, you know, will Scotland be able to stand on its own 2 feet? Where's the information? I think the information is there, and the case is there that Scotland would be a wealthy independent nation. But people also ask, you know, wouldn't independence mean uncertainty? Wouldn't independence mean risk? And I don't think that's the case at all. The biggest risk to Scotland would be remaining within the UK under Westminster, where there are huge risks to the economy, like the threat of a future UK government taking Scotland out of the European Union, which would be really bad for trade and for exports and for businesses as well. And there's other threats that have already been mentioned, like threats to services and to jobs that have happened for a generation because of Westminster governments. You know, UK politicians went up to Rosyth and to the Clyde in 1979, they went up to Linwood and they said, if you have a Scottish assembly, these jobs will go. They said, if you have a Scottish economy, there's a threat to Scottish manufacturing. The real threat to Scottish manufacturing, whether it was at Linwood or at Ravenscraig, came from a UK government that didn't represent Scottish interests and didn't stand up for the Scottish economy. Those same threats are being made today. Well, you have Tory government ministers coming up to the Clyde, to BAE Systems, to Rosyth, and saying your jobs are at threat if you vote for independence. And I don't think that's credible, because the world is constantly changing. As we've seen in the last three decades, there are constant risks in the world where there are problems with the economy, especially with what's happened to manufacturing. But the greatest risk is to let someone else make those decisions on your behalf. The greatest opportunity is to have power and control in an uncertain world, to be able to make your own decisions and to be able to chart your own course when it comes to creating new jobs. And I'm just going to set out quickly six huge opportunities for the Scottish economy that can only come through independence. First is you save money. Over 5 years, Scotland would save at least £3 billion in reallocating some of its spending decisions. So first and foremost, that comes with moving Trident nuclear weapons off the Clyde and not wasting over £100 billion on a new generation of Trident nuclear missiles. But the Scottish Trade Union Congress, for instance, in one of the reports said, costs a lot more money and loses jobs because it concentrates a lot of this money in a system we don't need with low employment, whereas if you reallocated this money, you could create far more jobs. Also in defence spending, like the White Paper proposal was to spend less on defence by at least £500 million per year. So that's another massive saving that comes with independence. We've also got savings in terms of administration of borders, and of course, probably the best saving of all, not spending £100 million a year on the House of Lords and the House of Commons. You know, could you think of a bigger waste of money than that? So you save a lot of money with independence. The second example is tax policy. Currently, Scotland has 7% control of its total tax policy. So that means 93% of all that revenue decision making is based in a government that Scotland doesn't have a direct link to, that Scotland hasn't voted for. With independence, rather than having 7% control of tax policy, you'll have 100% control of tax policy, which means the tax decisions we make and the policies we make will better suit companies and people who live in Scotland. So that's a second huge opportunity. A third example is childcare, which I'm sure might be brought up in a few of the later speeches. But from an economics point of view, expanding childcare is, according to some of the reports that we've put out, an opportunity to create 35,000 new jobs in the care sector. So by investing in these new services, you also have an opportunity to bring more people back to work. Sir Donald Mackay, who was head of Scottish Enterprise, said that it's a huge opportunity to increase tax take by bringing more people into the workplace, and it creates more jobs. Another example that I've already mentioned is industrial policy. This is huge and I think requires a lot more work. We need to start thinking about construction and engineering and building things in Scotland again, which has been decimated by previous Westminster governments. With control over those powers in areas like research and development and total control over planning and investment, Scotland needs to start thinking about taking a lead and creating new jobs, especially in Glasgow. Like over in Belfast Docks, they've renovated Belfast Docks to take in lots of renewables equipment so they can move it and cater for that in Belfast. that type of project, that type of investment should be happening in Glasgow. There's no reason that with leadership and with research and investment from some of the world's top universities, we can't be building these things in Glasgow with some top engineering companies like the Real Group. It's another huge policy and another huge opportunity and an opportunity for jobs that we can take with independence. Another example is the National Energy Fund. And I like kind of using a football metaphor for this, because 30 years ago, when they discovered North Sea oil, they could have done what Norway has done, and they could have started a national oil fund, but they didn't. And now we have a case where 30 years of North Sea oil, £300 billion worth of tax money has been squandered. And in Norway, they're sitting across the North Sea with $840 billion, in a national energy fund, which makes them the richest country in the world. Because they put part of their natural resources, their natural energy resources, into an investment fund for future generations. So we're at half-time in this weird game of football with oil, and we have a decision about whether we take it into Scotland's hands and invest in an energy fund, which is the position of the Yes campaign, or we let Westminster squander the second half of that natural resource. I think that's another huge opportunity for future investment that you get for Yes vote. And finally, an opportunity to increase exports. I've already mentioned that Scotland's a huge exporter and does a lot of business with countries across the world. But if you phone up the UK trade and investment groups that exist across the world, Scotland's not on their radar. I phoned them up last November to ask what they were doing to promote Scottish goods and services around St Andrew's Day in 25 key export locations from Brazil to France to Germany to Norway to the United States, and not one single embassy or trading location was doing anything to promote Scotland on that day in terms of events and in terms of promotion, which is embarrassing. These are like a great asset and a great resource that Scotland has that are being failed by the current system. With independence, Scotland will have greater opportunities internationally to promote the goods and services that are made here. And like I mentioned earlier, a 50% increase in those companies and in those areas can create 100,000 new jobs over the next generation. So Scotland is a wealthy country. There are risks in the future, but the best way to counter those is by having control over our own future. And there are huge economic opportunities that can be unleashed through a vote for Scottish independence. Thank you very much.